Nobody wants to live under the cloud of guilt and shame. So let's pray for our kids to find that freedom. Or say they're anxious, like right now, especially with everything that our country's been through, whether it's COVID, whether it's political divisions, racial tensions, any of that, anxiety is bubbling up. It's like that, you know, hum of the refrigerator sort of in our lives, right? Just it's there. And even the most joyful people I know are sort of grappling in a way. Our kids too. And so I love to just pray Philippians 4, verse 6 over my kids and over me. Don't be anxious about anything. Lord, let us not be anxious about anything. People often ask me what I mean when I say praying the scriptures. And it's certainly not any kind of magic formula, and it's not the only way we can pray. In fact, not long ago, I was reminded of what happened when our daughter went off to her first day at a new school, and she came home and told my husband and me that she thought her new teacher was a Christian. And we said, wow, you know, how can you tell? And she said, well, every day she prays. And we said, wow, she prays? It was a public school. And I said, tell me more about this. I want to know. And she said, yes, Mom, every day. She says, oh God, help me get through this day. And she said, and some days she just says, oh God, help. And she puts her head down on her desk. Well, that made me laugh. I laughed then and I laugh now. And my heart goes out to that teacher because honestly, we've all prayed that, oh God, help, haven't we? And it's a perfectly legitimate prayer. In fact, it's a scripture prayer. We see King David praying it all the time. Lord, help. But when I say praying the scriptures, I'm more talking about using the Bible, God's written word, as part of a conversation, as a launching pad for our prayers. For example, we might ask God to help our children be kept healthy and safe. And that's a great prayer. What parent doesn't want their child to be healthy, to be protected, to be safe? Good prayer. But consider how much richer, deeper, all-encompassing it sounds if you prayed it, say, in the language of the Psalms, in Psalm 5, verses 11 and 12. The psalmist writes, spread your protection over them, surround them with your favor as with a shield. I love praying that for my child. Lord, spread your protection over them, surround them with your favor as with a shield. Or in Psalm 121, where it says, he will watch over your coming and going now and forever. As our children leave our house and we don't know where they'll be all day or who they'll be with, we can just say, Father, watch over their coming and their going now and forever. So that's what I mean when I say praying the scriptures. And when we do that, when we tap into God's word, we can be confident of a couple of things. One, we're praying according to his will because he's the one that said it. He initiated it. And second, those words come with power. Those prayers come with power. Jeremiah 1:12, God says he's always watching over his word to perform it. Isaiah 55 tells us that God's word, he says, it does not go out. When it goes out, it does not return empty, but always accomplishes the purposes for which I sent it. That's what God says. And Hebrews 4:12 says God's word is alive and it's active and it's sharp and it discerns, it weighs motives. So it is a power tool. And when we use it, we just tap into that. I say our prayers release God's power to accomplish his purposes. And when we pray the scriptures, when we pray God's word back to him, we can know that we are praying prayers that line up with his will and his best plans for the lives of the people we love. I was praying Ephesians 4:29, let no unwholesome talk come out of your mouth, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it would benefit those who listen. That's a mouthful, but what it really was, in my southern language, was no ugly talk, because my kids were doing a lot of ugly talk, and I was too, and I just thought, that's not helping anybody. So I was praying Ephesians 4:29, and I was really seeing God begin to shape our speech patterns, and I thought, I wonder what other parents are praying, you know, what do you want God to do for your family? Well, I asked that question to lots of people. In fact, more than 100 people. I did surveys and I handed them out in the carpool line, in the grocery store, tucked them in Christmas cards. And people got back to me. I got more than 100 surveys back. And folks wanted wisdom and compassion for their kids, character traits like that, like diligence and self-control. They wanted God to bless relationships with friends, with siblings, with teachers. safety and protection, as we talked about earlier. They wanted salvation, their kids to know and love God's word. And parents, even of the youngest children, were praying about their future, who they'd marry, what their purpose in life would be. So I took all of these answers and divided them into 20 different topics. And that launched the first book, Praying the Scriptures for Your Children, because I went through and I thought, let's see what the Bible has to say about each of these concerns. And what I discovered, and what you probably already know, is that there's not a need that we're going to face or a desire we have for our kids that God has not already thought of and provided for in His Word. And so again, when we tap into those words and pray His Scriptures, we accomplish His purposes. So I got really excited about that, and that's what led to the book. And then my kids got older and they became teenagers, and I picked up the first book and I thought, I didn't put anything in here about driving or dating or underage drinking or any of these teen-specific issues. So I kind of went back to the drawing board, interviewed a whole bunch of teen parents, because if you've seen the books, you know they're filled with stories from real people just like you and me, because I think it's really important for us to know that we're not alone. We're not the only one whose kid is sneaking out, whose preschooler is biting somebody, whose adult child can't find a job. There's plenty of parents in there with us, and we're praying. So I did that with the teens book. Again, interviewing parents, sharing their stories, and sharing God's answers to prayer. And each chapter ends in all the books with a collection of 10 or 12 scripture-based prayers we can pray. Because I know, I don't know about you, but for me, in the moment, sometimes I can't find that verse that I really need because my child needs wisdom or they're in a conflict with a friend. And I love being able to just turn to that chapter. My children tease me. They say, Mommy, reading your own book again, you know, but I do. And then my kids grew up, my teenagers grew up, and they became adults and they started going off to college and into careers, moving out of our house. And I realized, you know what? You never stop being a parent. You never stop praying. There's a whole new world of issues out there for how your child is thriving in the workplace or not, where they can find a place to live, you know, that isn't with you. We went through that in our family. So all of those issues, and then trickier stuff too, dealing with addiction, substance abuse, rocky marriages and crumbling relationships, all that stuff God cares about, and He wants us to bring those needs to Him. Lamentations 2, pour out your heart like water before the Lord. Lift up your hands to Him for the lives of your children. He tells us to do that. And when we do that, He hears us and He answers, and He is faithful. A lot of people tell me they don't really know how to get started in prayer. Like, how do I do it? How do I sound good? And that's one of the reasons that I wanted to go through and pull scriptures that parents could use. On my website, jodieberndt.com, you'll find prayer calendars for children, for teens, and for adult children that have just little short scripture prayers that you can pray, one prayer a day over the whole month. Say your child is struggling to be kind or compassionate. That day might be listed under kindness, and you might find Ephesians 4:32. Be kind and compassionate to one another, forgiving each other, just as in Christ God forgave you. Or, living without shame, finding that freedom and that forgiveness. We know, 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just, and He will forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And for our kids to know that, and for us to be able to pray that for them, that they would be quick to confess, that God would cleanse them. I just think that's a great prayer, that because nobody wants to live under the cloud of guilt and shame. So let's pray for our kids to find that freedom. Or say they're anxious, like right now, especially with everything that our country's been through, whether it's COVID, whether it's political divisions, racial tensions, any of that, anxiety is bubbling up. It's like that, you know, hum of the refrigerator sort of in our lives, right? Just it's there. And even the most joyful people I know are sort of grappling in a way. Our kids too. And so I love to just pray Philippians 4 verse 6 over my kids and over me. Don't be anxious about anything. Lord, let us not be anxious about anything, but let us come before You with thanksgiving and present our requests to You. And then verse 7 is a beautiful promise. It says, the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. So I love to pray that. Lord, don't let my children be anxious about anything, but let them come to You. Let them share their needs with You with thanksgiving. And let Your peace settle over them, just bringing that calm, bringing that freedom from anxiety, from fear, from worry, from any of those things that would try to steal their joy. Let them walk in confidence with You, Lord.